Keep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep if I should die before I wake. That's a scary part. I pray the Lord my soul to take. That was one of the main ones. But we went to church sporadically. We didn't go all the time. A lot of it depended upon my kids' work schedule. But seeds were being planted then through Sunday school. I went to the Church of Christ. I remember when I was really small, and I remember the stories of David and Elisha. Saying the sinner's prayer, and this is going to Sunday school class, and I meant it with all my heart when I said it, and I love hearing the stories of God and wanting to know more about but the Lord. But being a kid, again, we didn't always go to church, and you know, that was something I did that Sunday, but then maybe next Sunday I went roller skating. But the seeds were planted, and so life went on. When I was 10, my father was diagnosed with terminal cancer. And so this was like a pivotal thing in my life. And he died when I was 12. He had a deathbed conversion, tears. He died, and I believe the Holy Spirit was still in our house that night. And I felt an overwhelming sense of God's presence and his holiness. And it was very frightening. But it was just like he gave me a glimpse of his Holy Spirit and his powerfulness, and it was something I don't think I could in my child's eye have created. But pushed on. 3 years later, my mother died unexpectedly, and that was devastating to us. And again, you had to harden your heart, you had to push on, you had to go forth and just get through it. I was 15 then, in my teen years. My sister, older sister, 22, she stayed with us for a while. My aunt and uncle were supposed to take us, but they were childless, and then after it happened, you know, my parents died. I don't think they were really cut out for that, but my sister did the best she could. She was a kid herself, actually, and she just got married, and she moved back home with us for a few years, and she moved, and my grandmother came. But anyway, we got through high school. My younger sister and I'm the middle child. Sister that's a year younger than me, born on the same day, and I'm an older sister that, you know, 8 years older than me, 7. Anyway, so we went to college, and it was the party years. It was the 70s. I thought that was a rite of passage. I just thought that's what you did. And when I look back on it, I feel like it just really delayed my growing up. Just kept me more in a state of adolescence. But that's what I did. I ended up getting married. I was very happy, happily married. A few years later, I had my son, and I was delighted. We got a new house, and that's when I was saved. I think I was 26, 27, and I had done everything to try to make this a good home. I wanted to have a happy life, just like everybody, with the baby, the home. But I knew something was missing, and there was rain coming in through the roof, and it was ruining all that paint and wallpaper. And God used this. It may seem like a superficial thing, but to me, I was wanting to start something new, but I needed the Lord. I really needed him, and I got down on my knees, and it's like, Lord, I'm trying to do. I feel like I've had a lot of ugly things in my life and bad things, and I want things to be different. And I just had a torrent of tears. I confessed every sin that I could think of, and there was just a newness. I didn't call it saved, but that's what it was, because afterwards I did have a hunger for God, and I wanted to get to know him better. And also, right about that time, after my prayer, somebody had hit our mailbox. He happened to be a roofer, and he came the following Saturday and fixed our roof. So I feel like God saved me, and he knew the cry of my heart. And the guy had a beard, and he looked like Jesus. So anyway, but so you know, then we had the opportunity to move to Michigan, and I also had another baby. I feel like he was in the midst of my situation. I felt like he wasn't doing what I thought he should do. So I won't say I totally turned my back. I knew somehow in the back of my mind he was the only answer, but I kind of walked away a little bit. And things didn't get better, they only got worse. But somewhere in all that, again, I felt like he came to me, and it was almost like, you know, I missed you when you used to walk closer to me. I missed you. He missed me. It's like, how could he miss me? But he brought me back. And he redeemed me. He restored me. He went after that lost sheep that he brought back.
Yeah.
And he's just done marvelous things in my life, things I don't deserve. He's blessed my children. You know, you always want the best for your kids. And in spite of it all, he has blessed them. He has blessed them, and he has brought us out so much that they cannot help but say, you know, God was with us, even in your darkest time. But, you know, way back he had started working on, when he saved me on the floor in that kitchen, turning a stony heart into flesh, and because that's how I got through life. That's how I made it through. It's almost like a PTSD. You hear about people coming through kind of like the war zone. Just kind of harden your heart. Mm-hmm. And that was my basis, and that's how I got through things. But he's been working on that heart. He's been changing it little by little. And again, you know, he says, I will give you a new heart, and I will put in you a new spirit and take away that stony heart. And that's what he's done. I feel like I was a... my life journey with the Lord, I was like a concrete block, and he just was tapping away, you know, little by little. But again, he's done wonderful things, and I just continue to grow in him, and I love him all the more, just like the woman that wept at Jesus' feet. I relate to that. Maybe because I realize all he saved me from, and he sometimes tells me even yet more what he saved me from to help me to understand what a horrible way my mindset had become that I didn't even realize at the time. You know, if I could go back, I would definitely do things differently. Even 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20, when I look back, I would certainly do things differently. But yet God was faithful and merciful unto me. Even when I wasn't faithful to him, he was merciful and gracious. And that smallest prayer, he does hear your smallest prayer. There's a verse, but you are a chosen race in 1 Peter 2:9, and that kind of spoke to me. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a consecrated nation, a special people for God's own possession, that you will proclaim the excellence, the wonderful deeds and virtues and perfection of him who calls you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And that's what he hopes for everyone. He doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants a relationship with you. And he still loves you when you make mistakes. He wants to bring you up higher, but he loves that relationship with you. The other day, I hear this all the time, again, I've already gotten off track. I'm sorry, a little bit longer, but I hear the word karma. You know, I hear people say it's karma, karma. And I thought, that's not in the Bible, karma. Mm-hmm. And I thought, karma is, you know, eye for an eye, tooth for, you get what you deserve. Well, when you come to Jesus, you get what you don't deserve. Mm. You get mercy, you get kindness, you get love, you get restoration, you get redemption. It is such a win-win proposition. I mean, anyway, it's just like, come to the Lord. It's just... it's beautiful, and like I say, he's still working on me. Shannon mentioned that song, he's still working on me. I looked at my oven the other day, I scrubbed it really good, but there was still a bit of